Good morning, students. Today we will start with the next topic of CS2 microprocessor. In the previous lecture, we have studied about what is microprocessor and what are the uses of microprocessor and what are the generations of microprocessor. And after that, we have started with the block diagram of microcomputer, where we have studied what is CPU, what is MPU, what is clock, RAM, ROM, keyboard and display, display that is output devices. Today we will study the remaining parts of this diagram. So what you have to do is you simply have to make a CPU in the middle, then keyboard interface and keyboard, clock, RAM, ROM, display interface and display. Now next is you have to draw a, there is a no need to draw all these lines and arrows and all, you can skip that part. You can simply connect all the blocks to each other by using bidirectional arrow, that is RAM, ROM, display. You can simply use bidirectional arrow to connect all these blocks. So after drawing all these blocks, what you have to do is you can simply draw a single line from keyboard to display, keyboard to display, and you can explain the buses like data bus, control bus and address bus. I hope it is clear to you that what is bus and why we use bus. I think I have explained all these things in the 11th standard, but again I will tell you what is bus. Bus is used to transfer the data from one place to another, to transfer the content from one place to another. And we have basically three types of buses: data bus, address bus and control bus. Data bus is used to transfer the data, whereas address bus is used to transfer the addresses, whereas control bus transfer all the signals, that is all the signals for now I will give you one example of everything, like because we also have to study all these things in the microprocessor, so you must know that what is data bus. So data bus is used to transfer the data. For example, you want to transfer data 0102. Now how much data you can transfer? You can transfer only that much data, what is the, whatever will be the size of the bus. For example, in the generations of microprocessor, we have studied that the first generation, in the first generation the size was 4 bit. So the size of the data bus was 4 bit. You can transfer only 4 bits if we are using first generation. In the second generation, look at this. In the second generation, we have studied that the size of the microprocessor was 8 bit, and the name of this generation of the microprocessor is 8085. So if we are using 8085 microprocessor, as the size is 8 bit, so the size of the data bus is 8 bit. So it means you can transfer 8 bits. So here you don't have to discuss all these things. These all things, I'm telling you all these things just because you must know that what is data bus and how much data we can transfer. So simply here you just have to discuss the data bus, address bus. Address bus is used to transfer the addresses, whereas control bus is used to transfer, this is control bus, to transfer all the control signals which are generated by the CPU. Control signals like, for example, if you try to open a file, if you try to search a file or open a file that you have not saved in your computer, so it will display you message that file does not exist. So this is a real life example of control bus, control signal. And one more real life example of the control signal is, for example, when you attach any pen drive to the computer, it gives you a message that a new device attached. So it means it gives you a signal, control signal. So these types of signals travel through control bus. So that is address bus, data bus and control bus. So you can simply draw a single line from keyboard to display and from CPU to memory, because addresses transfer between CPU to memory, and you can write address bus and data bus. The next line is power supply line. Power supply line is used to provide power supply. So you can simply draw a single line and you can make a block power supply. Next is power line. Power line is, for the real life example of power line, is cable that you use to plug in or through which the current transfers. That is power line. Power supply transfers through power line. So that's it. You just have to draw the basic diagram and you have to explain all these things when you get a question like what is a microcomputer, what is the block diagram of a microcomputer. Now if you check this diagram, this is the basic version of this diagram. So see, this is input and here it is input interface and this is CPU. In the CPU there are two units, ALU and CU, and output is output device, and here there must be an output interface. In the memory there are RAM and ROM. So this is actually a explained version of this diagram. So it is up to you, if you want to use this diagram you can also use this diagram, but it is detailed diagram of microcomputer. Now next is, these are all the terms I have mentioned here, what you have to explain in the microcomputer. Input devices, so what are input devices? Are used to give the input to the computer. The example of input devices are keyboard and mouse. Output devices are the devices which are used to check the output, and the example of output devices are monitor, printer. Next is MPU or CPU, microprocessor or central processing unit. It is the brain of the computer. It is used to perform all the processing. It is used to process the data. It receives the input from the input devices, process it and provides output. Clock is used to provide clock, because computer operates with clock. Clock driven devices, RAM, what is RAM, what is ROM, bus. In the bus you have to explain address bus, data bus and control bus. Power line, and there is one more thing, decoder. What is address decoder? Decoder is used to decode the address. In the later video I will explain you about the address decoder in the 8085. So these all are the basic things of microcomputer. I hope it is clear to everyone. It is very simple question and it is very easy to understand. So students, we have not started with the microprocessor. We have just started the basic microcomputer. Basic microcomputer is what are the things that are involved in basic microcomputer. So we have studied all these things. Now we have to start with the next topic, generic microprocessor. Now what is generic microprocessor? See, here we are not discussing any particular microprocessor. For example, if you people are using different phones, like someone is using Samsung phone, someone is using Apple phone, and someone is using some other phone. So in the general structure we study like what are the basic functions of a phone. Whether it can be of any company or any brand, it doesn't matter. But what basic functions every phone provide, like calling function, multimedia functions, memory, these all things are the general things. So similarly here, we have to start generic microprocessor. Generic means a general microprocessor. So before starting with the particular microprocessor, we have to study the general microprocessor, that in a general microprocessor, what are different parts or what are the different blocks in a microprocessor. So with this, we start with the generic microprocessor. So I have taken two examples of general microprocessor. You can make use of any of the diagram. It is up to you. It is your choice, whatever you want to use. So I want to explain you first this diagram. Look at this diagram. So what microprocessor? These are the units of a simple microprocessor. One is control unit. Control unit means, as we have studied, that CPU, in the CPU there are two parts, ALU and CU. I hope that everything, it is clear to everyone that what is ALU and CU, because I have explained you in the 11th standard. ALU is arithmetic logic unit, which is used to calculate, which is used to perform all the calculations, whereas control unit is, which is used to generate control signals. So these are the two units of a general microprocessor. Next is registers. Microprocessor always make use of different types of registers. Earlier I have explained you that it make use of register to store the data, to store the temporary results, and also it make use of registers. Next is instruction decoder. Instruction decoder is when we give instruction to the microprocessor. Whenever we give instruction to the microprocessor, then instruction decoder decodes that instruction. Decodes that instruction means it tells the microprocessor that what he has to do, that what user want to perform, or what is the meaning of the instruction that user has entered. For example, I have entered sum A comma B. So instruction decoder is used to decode the instruction that there is a need to perform addition operation on variable A and variable B. So this is instruction decoder. And apart from that, it also making you it also makes use of data bus. Data bus means to travel the data. So this is the very basic diagram of a microprocessor. So if you get a question, you can get a question like, what is the generic microprocessor? Generic microprocessor means you have to explain the general parts of a microprocessor. So you can make use of any of the diagram. Now this is the second diagram of a general microprocessor. You can make use of any of the diagram. Look at this diagram. Here, this is the microprocessor. Microprocessor means CPU, that is MPU. Then clock. Clock is used to provide clock pulse. Memory. In the memory, there will be RAM, ROM. External peripherals, that is input-output devices. And these are the buses, data bus, address bus, and control bus. The data bus is used to transfer data, address bus is used to transfer address, whereas control bus is used to transfer control signals. Now you can get a question like in the form of MCQ. So I want to tell you one thing, the data bus of microprocessor is always bidirectional. Bidirectional means it travels in both the directions, that is from CPU to memory and from memory to CPU. That's why there are arrows on both the sides of the data bus. Data bus is always bidirectional, whereas address bus is always unidirectional, and control bus is always unidirectional, because addresses are always generated by the CPU. So it always travel from CPU to main memory, and the control signals are also always generated by CPU, and that's why they always travel from CPU to memory. So this CPU to memory or CPU to peripherals. And again, addresses also travels from CPU to memory, CPU to peripherals, that is input-output devices. So this is the reason why data bus is bidirectional, whereas address bus and control bus is unidirectional. And you can also get a question in the on the topic like buses. What is data bus? What is address bus? What is control bus? So you have to explain all these buses, that data bus is used to transfer the data, and you can also explain this thing, that the data bus is always bidirectional, whereas the address bus is used to carry the addresses. It always carry addresses from CPU to main memory or peripheral. So that's why this is the reason this is unidirectional, because addresses are always generated by the CPU. Whereas control bus is also unidirectional, because control signals are always generated by the CPU, and it travels to either input output devices, that is peripherals or memory. So this is the second journal diagram of microprocessor. You can make use of any of the diagram. Now next is, you have to explain all these things in detail, and even you can get a question on one of the basic thing, like what is bus, what is instruction decoder, what is clock in microprocessor, why we use clock in microprocessor, what is ALU, what is CU. So you can get question in any form or in any of the term. So in the journal microprocessor, we have to study all these things. I hope the diagram is clear to everyone. If diagram is clear to everyone, now it is very simple to explain all these terms. So I have written all the terms what you have to explain, that is what are the journal things of a microprocessor. So the first very general thing of a microprocessor is ALU. ALU is arithmetic logic unit, which is used to perform all the calculations, all the addition, subtraction, comparisons, like A is less than B, Boolean functions, whether this condition is true or false. So these all the things are done by the ALU. Next is registers. What is register? Students, now I want to tell you what is register. Register is, for example, in your real life, you make use of register to store data, to make notes. Register, for example, you have a notebook at your home, this is known as register, and you make use of this register to write notes so that you can save your notes and you can refer it in future whenever you require that notes. Similarly, in the computer, there are registers. Now, what are registers? Registers reside on the CPU. Registers reside on the CPU. Different types of registers are available to perform different types of tasks. Next is, registers operate at a very fast rate. The reason is, it resides on the CPU. So whenever CPU has to receive the data from the register, it is very easy for the CPU, because there is no distance between the CPU and the register, because registers resides on the CPU. So CPU can receive the data from the registers at a very fast rate and can process it and stores the results back in the register if CPU wants. So registers are one of the fastest memory. Register is a type of memory, because we are using registers to store the data. So register is one of the fastest memory. Register also operates at a very fast rate than RAM. So register is one of the fastest memory. If you get a question like, what is the fastest memory of a microprocessor or any computer? So the answer is registers. Now, there are different types of registers in a microprocessor. The names are accumulator, general purpose register. The name of the general purpose registers are register B, register C, register D, register E, register H, register L. So these are the general purpose register, temporary register, program counter, instruction register, stack pointer, and status register. These are the names of the register. Now I will explain you all the registers and the working of a register, because when we start with the 8085, we make use of some very important registers, and it is very important that you must know the definition and the use of that register. And from exam point of view, they can also ask any of the register in your exam, like what is accumulator, what are the general purpose registers of a microprocessor, or anything like that. So you must know the definition of each and every register and the task of every register. Now I will explain you with the first register, that is accumulator. Accumulator is very important register. Accumulator is processor register, or it is also known as processing register, because accumulator is used to perform processing. So this is the reason accumulator is known as processor register. You can also get a question in the form like, what is processor register? And we always denote accumulator with symbol A. Symbol A. Accumulator is very important register. It is used to perform all the processing. CPU most commonly make use of accumulator to perform processing. So this is the reason it is known as processor register, because it is used to perform processing. And we use it to perform, we denote it with symbol A. Next is general purpose register. Microprocessor provides different types of general purpose register. General purpose, as the name is general purpose, they are used in general way, that whenever CPU has to store the data, transfer the data, or whatever CPU wants, CPU can use these types of registers. So there are total 6 general purpose register, and we can also use these registers in pair. We will study in 8085 how we can use in pair. So the name of the general registers are register B, register C, register D, register D, E, register H, and register L. And if we have to use general purpose registers in pair, we make pair as register B, C. We always make pair of the B with C, that is register B, C, D, E, and H, L. B, C, D, E, and H, L. And most commonly, the size of the general purpose register is 8. For example, if we discuss about register A, register B, the size of the register B is 8 bit. Most commonly, the size of the general purpose register is 8 bit, whereas the size of the accumulator is also 8 bit, because 8 bit means I will explain you in 8085 the sizes of different registers, because the sizes of registers vary between different microprocessors. For example, if you have a phone and you have 16 GB memory, and when you buy a new phone with the advanced version, and you are getting 32 GB memory. So this is how the advanced versions have higher memory. Similarly, the size of the registers also vary from some specific microprocessor to some specific microprocessor. So there is no need to discuss the size in case of general microprocessor. So in general microprocessor, you can skip the size. So these are the general purpose registers, and we can use it in pair like B, C, D, E, and H. Next is temporary register. As the name is temporary register, temporary register is used to store temporary results. Temporary results. For example, you want to add 10 numbers by using the computer. So when we enter 10 numbers like 1 plus 2 plus 5 plus 6 plus 7 plus 9, so computer make use of temporary registers, because for example, CPU is performing the sum of first two numbers and store the result in the register, and then perform sum of third and fourth number and store the result in temporary, and then pick the result from the temporary and then add it with the number. Whatever CPU wants to do, CPU makes use of temporary register to store the data temporarily, or to store the temporary results. As the name is temporary, it is CPU use it for temporary time, not for permanent time. Next is program counter. Program counter is one of the main important register of CPU. We will also study about program counter in 8085. Now let's start with what is the definition of program counter. program counter contains the definition is program counter contains the address of the next instruction to be executed. Program counter contains the address of the next instruction to be executed. It means, for example, if CPU is executing any instruction at that time, now when the execution of that instruction completes, now what next CPU has to execute? So what next CPU has to execute? CPU always get it from the program counter. Whatever address will be in the program counter, CPU execute it at after executing the current instruction. So for example, we want to execute 10 instructions. So what we have to do is, what computer do is, it gives the address of all the instructions to the program counter one by one, and then CPU picks the instruction from the program counter one by one and execute in that manner. So program counter is used to store the address of the next instruction to be executed. So that is what will be the next instruction that we have to execute after this instruction. Next is instruction register. Instruction register is used to store the instructions. As the name is instruction register, it is used to store the instructions, and it is also used as I have told you that decoder, that what is instruction, I will explain you in the third step. So here I will explain you why we use instruction register. So the main definition of the instruction register is it is used to store the instructions. Instructions means what instructions we give to the computer, it is known as instruction. And how the computer performs according to our instruction, because it stores the instructions in the instruction register and then analyze it. Next is stack pointer. Stack pointer means if the register is in the form of the stack and it stores the data in the form of the stack, and then make use of pointers. Next, last register is status register. Status register, as the name is status, it is used to indicate the status of different flags. Status register is also known as flag register. Flag register means in microprocessor we make use of different types of flag registers, and status register is used to indicate the status of that register, that whether flag is active or not. So that's all for today. Tomorrow we will start with the next third part, that is instruction decoder. Today we have studied ALU and registers. Tomorrow we will start with instruction decoder. So that's all for today.